Hello and welcome to Before the Downbeat, a musical podcast. My name is Mackenzie Horner and I'm one of the hosts for this podcast. And joining me is my friend, mentor, and extremely talented director, and the Canadian B. Arthur, Autumn Smith.
Oh, wow. How do I live up to that, B. Arthur? I love it.
So to give our listeners some background on us, I'll start by letting them know that we actually met back in spring of 2015. When we were both at York University. I was in my third year studying device theater and directing. You were finishing your master's. We both were just trying to survive and avoid strikes, you know, that type of thing. And then we get partnered on this little show called A Tales of Ovid, adapted by Ted Hughes. You were the director. I was your assistant director.
That's right. And you were great.
Oh, thank you.
I couldn't have done it without you.
So now that's our history. So Autumn, why don't you tell us a little bit about yourself? Who are you?
Oh, this is the part I loathe. I am a theater director, an innovator, an administrator, an artist educator. Mm-hmm. I have worked across the globe. I ran a Dora Award-winning theater company called Mackenzie Row.
Ooh,
it was an Irish repertory theater company.
Of course, the Celtic Irish, yeah.
Of course, indeed. Mm-hmm. I've also been an avid musical theater lover.
Love for it. Years.
I mm-hmm. started in mm-hmm. musical theater
okay.
as a kid.
Love it. What was your first show?
Music Man.
76 trombones led the big parade with 110 cornets close at hand. They were followed by rows and rows of the finest virtuosos, the cream of every famous band. 76 trombones caught the morning sun with 110 cornets right behind. There were more than 1,000 reeds springing up like weeds. There were horns of every shape and kind.
Classic.
I know. I was a dancer in the chorus.
Okay.
Yeah, I was the child dancer.
Love it. Are you the kid that plays the piano with Mary and Pirelli?
Amaryllis? No, I was not. I tried out for Amaryllis, but there was someone else. They beat me to it.
Damn them.
And then from that point on, I got cast as inanimate objects, animals, and men. So
very good.
I know.
A true B. Arthur.
You don't even need to see me and you get the visual. And now I work for the Canadian Children's Opera Company.
Love it.
I'm a professor at York, a professor at Centennial College. Mm-hmm. So things are great. And I just finished a tenureship at Canadian Stage as their director of education.
Love it.
Where I curated and conceived a new show called Territorial Tales.
I've heard about it. Tell us a little bit more, though.
So basically, we got source material from youth across Ontario.
Okay.
And we chose six pieces that we created into a theatrical piece that we toured across the province.
Oh, fantastic.
Yeah,
love
it. Was
it.
Great. About our relationship to land, our relationship to family. Mm. Home. Yeah, it was great.
Fascinating.
It was really, really great.
I love it.
Thanks. And what about you?
Oh, Matt? Wow.
I mean, come on.
Okay, well, I mean, where do we start? I guess we can start when I was three.
Wow.
That's when
not so long ago.
I know, right? Eons ago. Not really, but it feels like eons. But yeah, 3 years old is when I first got into theater because my grandparents gave my parents a copy of Les Miserables, 10th anniversary, on VHS.
Oh man, you just aged me.
I know, right? It's hard to believe that show is 30 years old. I guess it's 31, 32 years old now. 1985 it came out, so...
Yeah.
Yeah,
31, 32. I was like 12 or 13.
I wasn't even born yet.
No. There you go, friends.
But yeah, that's how I started. I saw that VHS tape of Colm Wilkinson belting his little heart out at the mic stand, and I thought, that's what I want to do.
That guy. I want to be that guy.
Actually, I want to be the innkeeper. That's the role
nice.
I've always wanted to be. I've always wanted to be Monsieur Thénardier.
Master of the house, doling out the charm, ready with an handshake and an open palm. Tempt the salty dial, makes a little stir. Customers appreciate the bon vivre. Glad to do me friends a favor. Doesn't cost me to be nice. But nothing gets you nothing. Everything has got a little price.
My parents gave back the VHS when I started singing the Lovely Lady song in every grocery store.
I smell women, smell them in the air. Think I'll drop my anchor in that harbor over there. Lovely lady, smell them through the smoke. 7 days at sea can make you hungry for a poke. Even stokers need a little stoke.
Lovely ladies waiting for a bite, waiting for the customers who only come at night. Lovely ladies ready for the call, standing up or lying down or anyway at all. Bargain prices up against the wall.
So my parents are like, hey, this tape has to stay with the grandparents.
It didn't stop you singing Lovely
Ladies. No, no, no.
Good for you.
No, the first song I ever learned in like musical theater was a prostitute song.
And we'll get to Les Mis in our probably third or fourth season.
It's true. It's true. We're saving that one for a special occasion.
It's our grand finale.
Exactly. It'll be the 100th episode that we'll do.
Yeah, exactly.
Les Mis, because I want to save that one. That's my personal favorite musical of all time.
Oh, wow.
Like that one is the number one show. So, wow. So when we do it, it will be a special occasion.
That's great.
I know, right? I'm excited for that.
It has a solid place in my heart too.
Right. So I watched Les Mis, and then at age 10, my dad found an open casting call for a local production here in Barrie of Oliver, done by Talk Is Free.
Oliver, Oliver, never before has a boy wanted more. Oliver, Oliver,
will toss for more when he knows what's in store. Nice.
So Oliver was my first show I ever did.
It's one of my favorites.
And definitely one I want to talk about, because that is one of my favorites as well. So yeah, Oliver was the first. I was the late orphan. I only appeared in one scene. Yeah, I only appeared in the opening scene with Food, Glorious Food, and Oliver. And then after that, they kick us off stage, and I was done for the rest of 3 hours.
Oh, that's
so
great.
So it got to the point where all the orphans, they didn't want to keep us around, so they actually had us do our bow at intermission for the audience,
man.
So we could all go home.
Way to go. That's smart.
Right?
When you're dealing with children,
yep.
Get them out of there as quickly
it's
as
true.
Possible. Is that it?
Exactly.
Wow.
But yeah, late orphan. It was my job to run in late to Food, Glorious Food, do a big, whew, wipe the sweat off my brow. That was my big opening moment into theater was that. And then from there, I did perform professionally in Barrie as well as doing community theater. So I did shows like Bye Bye Birdie, Grease, The Music Man, Zoozicle, all those types of fun shows that every local company does. So we did that. And then I graduated and went off to high school. And then I ended up behind the table because I was studying at York and doing devised theater. And I was like, know what? I'd rather be behind the table. And sure enough, I just found my way back there one time where I was late to a rehearsal. So I couldn't perform. So I was like, I was going to sit and be the outside eye. And I was like, I like this a lot more. It's more fun being the creative guy behind the table, being able to tell people what you want to see versus being a show being like, I don't like this vision. So
I call it the fool's perspective.
Right?
Right?
Explain that for the audience, though.
Well, being a director, as a director, mm-hmm. I still bring in an outside eye.
Yep.
To say, this works, this doesn't work, because the fool is the person that gets it. They see everything. They're a nonpartisan thought process and opinions. So they just tell you the truth about what's working, what's not working.
Exactly.
I love it.
I love it too.
It's like being an adjudicator.
Very true.
Right?
Very, very true.
Yeah.
I love it. Okay. So, yeah, so did that, graduated from York with honors, and now I work at Medieval Times in Toronto.
Woohoo!
Yeah, exactly, where now I get to sell theater to lovely school children.
I've only been to Medieval Times once.
Well, you have to come back. That is something.
I will, but my knight won.
Well, see, that's the best thing.
So I was excited, and now there's a queen, so
there
I
is.
Must go back. Yes.
Exactly. So,
and my partner adores Medieval Times. So
I know Sarah's got to get down there.
Yeah, we got to get her in, and the kids love it. So,
The more reason.
I know. Birthday party coming up.
Do it. Do it. Okay, let me know because I'll be there with you to celebrate.
Okay, let's do it.
Okay, done.
Very organized.
All right. Well, I guess that actually is enough talk about us. Our first episode, we're going to do something different than what we normally do.
Yes.
We're going to talk about the types of songs that are in a show. Because when we get into talking about our favorite songs and least favorite songs of a show, you're going to want to kind of know a little bit about what the heck we're talking about.
Yes.
So together, we have compiled a list of 14 types of songs that you may come across in a show. Probably, most likely, most definitely. But there are probably a few types of songs that we missed.
Probably.
And if we do, we'll bring them up whenever we bring up a song that fits that mold. But for the most part, these are
sometimes songs will fit many molds.
It's true.
Yeah.
Exactly. And I'm sure we'll definitely come across a few of those where it's like, ah, that song fits this mold, that mold, and also is a I Want song all in one.
Absolutely.
Right? So
absolutely.
We'll most certainly be talking about those as well. But for now, we'll go through our 14 types of songs in a musical.
Okay, so do you want to start?
I'll start us off because I have the first one of the list, which is Overture.
You have the first two, actually.
I do. So we'll most certainly get into that. So the first song that you, or piece of music you always hear in a show, is the Overture.
Ta-da.
Exactly. It opens the show. It introduces audiences to the musical motifs and melodies, which is important because as an audience, you don't want them to be jarred every time they hear a new musical motif or melody.
Yeah, you want to familiarize them with it.
Exactly.
Right?
You want to make sure they know what they're going to be going and listening to. Now, sometimes a overture can be really long and go through every single motif, like a Gypsy or a Phantom of the Opera. Say a show like Wicked or Les Mis, where it's just opening big bass downbeat notes. That then go right into the opening number.
Yeah, contemporary musical theater tends to be shorter.
Yes.
On the overture.
Exactly. They don't seem to want to really focus on that because they don't, I think their shows just have other things they want to do, and doing an overture kind of sometimes feels a little bit dated.
Well, and I think it's just when overtures first started, there was a blend of symphonic.
Yeah.
Like we were coming out of operetta and opera and symphony into a brand new genre. So I think they felt it was necessary to put it there.
Yes. Yes. I agree with that. Just it's making sure the audience kind of knows where you're going and just making sure audience go, oh, this is what we're doing.
Yeah. We're training them. Right?
Exactly. Because in every opera or ballet, there always is an overture. Yeah. So.
And we don't need to train them anymore.
No, exactly. Audiences just know going in, it's like, hey, I'm going to go see Wicked. I know what's going to happen here. It's Witches of Oz. Or maybe it's like I don't know how you'd even do an overture to that show because of the amount of motifs and things like
either.
That. Exactly.
I do not either. What's your favorite overture?
I think it would have to be Oklahoma.
Oklahoma.
I love the overture from Oklahoma with that first opening trill. And then it goes right into the big... Bum, 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 bum. Do Farmer and the Cowman Must Be Friends motif.
Oh, nice.
And it segues into Mary. It's a Mary and New Manson, or no? Out of My Dreams.
Out of My, I love that song.
It segues into that, and then it gets back into Oklahoma, the title song. So it just spans the whole gamut.
I think mine is Annie.
That's such a good one.
It's the trumpet.
It's true.
Like, it's great. I love it. It's so simple. And clear, and there's a pining to it.
We'll be right back. that's all Annie is. It's a lot of pining. Yeah.
But then it goes into a lot of like happy.
It's true.
It plays the opposites, which exactly. Is
okay, I don't think I've heard the overture for Annie a lot, so that's something I'll have to go back to. And when we talk about I'll talk about Annie later this season, we will certainly will be listening to that overture at some point because it's fantastic.
It's great.
I love it.
Yeah.
Okay, so that's the overture. It kind of sets you up and gets the audience in the mood.
Full instrumental.
Exactly. It's all instrumental. Awesome. I mean, sometimes there's a few cases where music does, or vocals do come in. Like, for example, I'm thinking the opening to Mary Poppins, the overture in the original Mary Poppins movie. You all of a sudden segue into Umdalilumdalai.
Yes.
With Supercalifragilistic's motif in there.
Yes.
So there are a few moments where that happens, but for the most part, it is always
Disney messing it all up.
I know. Gosh darn it, Sherman Brothers. Oh, well.
Man.
But yeah, for the most part, instrumental sets up the motifs and melodies. Then we get into the opening number.
Ta-da!
Exactly. So there are two types of opening numbers I've found in a musical. So, and they're both designed to do the same thing, which is to set up the world, draw in the audience, and kind of get the characters brought out on stage.
Sure.
So the first one you have is a musical opening number sung by the whole company. So that's something like Belle from Beauty and the Beast, where
love it.
I know it's still, actually that's one of my favorite Disney songs of all time.
For sure,
is Belle, because in 7 minutes you get to know who Belle is, you know what she wants.
Yeah, it's also an I want song, which we're going to get to in a minute.
Exactly. So it's an I want song. It sets up the villain and his plot right away with like Gaston was saying he's going to marry Belle. You also get the whole concept of who the community is that she's living in with their small, simple-minded
monotony
of everyday life. I love the villagers in Beauty and the Beast.
My kids love it too. They love the opening. In fact, when we're on Spotify in the car,
yeah,
can you play Belle?
I love it. I love those kids. They're right after my own heart there.
Yeah.
But yeah, Belle. That's a good example of a big show opening. Everybody's in it together. It's cacophonous. You got people like leaping in over each other. It's very big, and that's what audiences a lot of times are used to for an opening number.
For sure.
Now, the other type is the opening sung by a soloist. So that's something like, "Oh, What a Beautiful Morning," which is something that we'll definitely talk about when we get to the Oklahoma episode, because that's one of my favorite songs of all time.
It's one of my favorites, too.
Okay, so there's a little sneak preview there.
Shared moment.
Exactly. Because like that song, like I love to be in the audience with the first time seeing that show, where like they're expecting the big Showboaty opening, because Showboat came before Oklahoma, historically speaking. And so here you are, you're thinking you're gonna have a big company opening, just like in all the operas and operettas you've seen before in Showboat, and then out comes Curly singing his solo song with Ann Eller churning the butter.
There's a bright golden haze on the meadow. There's a bright golden haze on the meadow. The corn is as high as a elephant's eye, and it looks like it's climbing clear up to the sky. Oh, what a beautiful morning. Oh, what a beautiful day. I got a beautiful feeling. Everything's going my way.
Yeah.
Like, it's just one of those
turns
things.
It on its head.
Exactly. And I think I couldn't find too many other big solo opening numbers. I think that's one of the few.
Annie.
That's true with Maybe.
Maybe.
Maybe far away, or maybe real nearby. He may be pouring her.
Which is also an I Want song.
See, so I think a lot of times if it's going to be an opening number that's also a solo, I think the big thing is it's going to be I Want.
Yeah.
I think that's a pretty good...
Bob Fosse was wrong then. We'll get into that in a moment.
We will. So I think that's it for me, because I have stuff that comes later in a show. So, Autumn, why don't you get into what you got on your list?
We've got the I Want song.
True.
Which you've mentioned like a couple of times already. So the I Want song is basically the protagonist's intent.
Yes.
What they want to achieve throughout the course of the musical.
Yep.
It's their dreams. So
yep.
maybe is a perfect example.
From Annie, yeah.
From Annie. Most people have said that Tomorrow
Ooh.
Is the I Want song. And I'm like, no way.
Tomorrow's the big showstopper number.
Well, yes. But it's also a soliloquy.
Yes, it is.
Right?
Yep.
But an I Want song has to have a motivation behind yep. it. And maybe is a perfect example mm-hmm. of that. Even though it defeats the Bob Fosse rule.
True.
Which says, it's the third song in every musical.
Yep.
Lies.
Actually, another good... I was supposed to say part of your rule from Little Mermaid.
Part of... Yes.
But once again, that's...
always has I Want songs.
And that's because Howard Ashman came in to Disney and said... cartoon should be like a Broadway show. That's
it
like the
who's it's and what's it's galore.
Exactly. You know, or Thingamabobs. You got 20.
20.
Exactly.
Not 19.
But the whole thing of that song is a great example of a classic I Want song where it's like, I want legs.
When's it my turn? Wouldn't I love to explore that shore up above? Out of the sea. Wish I could be part of that world.
Yeah, to walk.
Exactly.
To ramble. So you have part of your world you have for the first time in forever.
Yes. From
great.
Frozen. Yeah, that's a
Go
good
the
one.
Distance.
Ooh, from Hercules. Another great one.
And even Let It Go.
Yes.
That's a great one,
let's
too.
Let's think about it. Yeah, because Let It Go. Yeah, that actually technically is the third song of the movie.
It's after For the First Time in Forever.
True.
But you have two protagonists.
It's true. So you,
right?
get, so you have to have two
so
I Want songs.
Two I Want songs.
Makes sense.
Now,
in classic Broadway, like what? So we have Maybe from Annie. What's another good example of an I Want song?
Into the Woods.
Oh, yeah.
So Into the Woods is more of an I Wish song.
It's true.
But it's what they, it's kind of what they want.
Yes.
Or they think that's what they want.
Exactly. We'll talk about that musical in season two.
Oh,
so
yes.
It's already on my list of shows we will talk about.
Yeah. One Song Glory from Rent.
Yeah.
That's a big I Want song.
That musical won't be appearing on this podcast for a while.
No.
I'll be like season 20.
Season 20. Chorus Line.
Ooh, yeah.
God, I Hope I Get It.
Yeah.
Somewhere Over the Rainbow.
Classic,
right?
Another song they almost cut from the movie because I thought it was too boring.
Too boring. Who can sit and watch literally someone sing, right?
It's true, right?
But
like, who's going
to
sit there?
People were trained to watch opera.
Exactly.
So
3 hours of that.
3 hours. 5 hours sometimes.
And sometimes
right?
in a foreign language that you didn't know.
Yeah. Now, the I Want song can fall in many different places.
It's true.
It can, like, fall at the beginning.
Yeah.
So it sets it up. It can set itself in the middle.
True.
It usually happens before act two, though.
Yes. Oh, it has to, because
has
act
to.
Two is all about resolution. So
that's right.
You guys set everything up to knock all the pins down later.
That's right. And it's usually the protagonist.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You know, you can have
very rarely have an anti-hero.
The I Want song.
Right.
Or you can have an I Want song, which can be any better.
So then what would you say the I Want song is in Les Mis? Because there's so many different characters in there. I mean, Valjean's soliloquy at the end of the prologue, I don't think it's an I Want song because it's an internal monologue.
I think they all have different I Want songs.
True.
I Dreamed a Dream is an I Want song.
Yeah, that's true.
That's
the fourth song in the show, though. It's not the third song.
I know. I don't know.
Tough one.
They all have different I Wants.
Mm-hmm. Same thing
but
with Phantom.
I Want song can also be a love song. Can be
true.
That's where we get.
Yeah, that's where it gets dicey.
A little murky.
Yeah.
Right?
In true Broadway fashion, nothing is straightforward.
Nothing is. It's like good classical theater.
Exactly.
Nothing is really straightforward.
No. There's no definitive answer to things.
No.
Unlike math.
But that's great. That's great.
Exactly.
It's great. It leaves us in the muck and mire of the human condition.
It's true.
Right?
Nobody stops and has their morning I Want song for the day.
I mean, I do.
I wish I did, but unfortunately, I'm on a go-to.
Every morning, I get up and I go, I want.
So what comes next on your list?
What's next on my list are love ballads, but I don't think we're there yet. What's next on your list?
I have the villain song.
Let's go there.
Okay. Sets up what the villain's going to do. Usually sets up their motivation, and usually there's a reprise of the villain's song in Act 2 to finish out their role. So within the villain's song, it usually sets up the villain's plot, or sometimes they can express the world philosophy that they see, or sometimes it's even just their simple their wants and desires.
Yeah.
It also can provide the audience with the villain's counter perspective on the musical's main plot. So
yeah. It shows their gray area.
Exactly.
If done properly.
True. Sometimes it just come off as pure mustache twirling. Very classic Disney, though. Disney does a lot of great villain songs
that are
just mustache twirling fun.
Like tentacle.
Yes.
Slashing poor unfortunate souls.
Yes.
I admit that in the past I've been a nasty. They weren't kidding when they called me, well, a witch. But you'll find that nowadays I've mended all my ways, repented, seen the light, and made a switch. True, yes.
Exactly. Poor fortunate souls, be prepared. Those are like the classic.
Le Poisson.
That's actually a fun villain song.
It is, but it's still a villain song.
It's true. It's true because Chef Louis does want to get Sebastian the crab.
Zut alors, I have missed one. Sacrebleu, what is this? How on earth could I miss such a sweet little succulent crab? Quel dommage, what a loss! Here we go, in the sauce! Now some flour, I think, just the dab.
Yep.
Now another thing the villain song usually does is normally if there's a plot that they have to do, like where it's like, I gotta kill this guy to do this thing, usually they're singing it within that song, and they're gonna tell the audience, this is what I'm gonna do, setting up what they have to do to get to their goal. And usually they're also one of the lackeys or sidekicks is there. Kind of like the hyenas in Lion King, or like LeFou in Beauty and the Beast. But then sometimes it's just sung solo on stage. So similar to like The Lonely Room in Oklahoma.
I ain't gonna dream about her arms no more. I ain't gonna leave her alone.
With Judd.
Or My Name.
My Name by Bill Sykes. That's true. But he comes out on stage. I was so sad they cut that from the film version.
Me too.
With Oliver Reed. But I understand why. Because their whole thing was, can you take a bad guy seriously in a film where the first thing he does is he comes out on stage and starts singing in his bass voice. And the thing is, Bill Sykes has to go be physically abusive to Nancy. Ultimately, he comes out as a murderer. I think it works well on...
It's such a good song.
It's a fantastic song.
How he has to perform...
To be evil.
Villainy.
What's bad? What's the good at turning? In hell! I'll be there a-burning. Meanwhile, think of what I'm earning. All on account of my name.
Yeah.
Right? Because he's not. No, and we talked about this a little bit before when we were talking about Sweeney.
It's true.
Is anyone truly good or evil?
True.
And that the interesting trajectory is to put them solidly in the middle.
Exactly.
Of that struggle between the two.
Exactly. So I think that's where Bill Sykes' song is really neat. Because he says, who cares? Like, right now I'm earning a ton of money being bad. So if I got to pay for it in the afterlife.
It's fine. But I also think it's a struggle for him to say that.
True. So I think that's a really interesting directing choice you can make with that character.
Absolutely.
Where you can make him look more conflicted.
Oh, the BBC version, straightforward dramatized version.
Is that the one with Andy Serkis as Bill Sykes?
There's a version with Andy Serkis as Bill Sykes. This is a newer version.
Oh, okay. Gotta look this one up then.
The guy that, I don't know who plays it.
Okay.
He's genius. But when he does his ultimate deed of killing Nancy, he goes a little crazy.
Ooh.
With guilt. Like the guilt is so big.
Interesting.
And he's someone who is unfortunately characterized by his class.
True.
And what would he have done if he had been moneyed?
Right.
Like what would his possibilities be?
True.
It's like Blood Brothers. Blood Brothers is a great musical for that.
That's one I don't know very much about.
Oh, it's great.
Okay, we'll have to do that one because it'll inspire me to listen
so
to
good.
It.
Petula Clark.
Okay.
Great.
And then sometimes a villain song, back to the villain song, is sometimes it's also a group number, like the Cell Block Tango.
He had it coming. He only had himself to blame. If you'd have been there,
farm in Chicago where it's all these merry murderesses telling their side of the story.
That's true. I never even thought of that.
Right? Anybody, technically, all these women did murder guys. I mean, the one guy, she shoots him with a shotgun because he's chewing gum on the couch.
Pop.
Yeah. Then the other one, and then the other one is like, she's cheating on like her husband with the mailman. So when he confronts her, she stabs him 10 times with the butcher's knife. But once again, it's all from their perspective because the villains don't think, a good villain never thinks that they are the villain. The villain always thinks that they are right. They're in the, like, they're not doing anything wrong.
But that's like any villain. Look at Ted Bundy. They're bringing in real life serial killers.
I love it. He's a hot topic right now.
But it's interesting.
Yeah.
Like, he's an interesting person to study.
Exactly.
Right? But that's what makes villain songs so great.
It's true. Okay. So next on my list, I have the soliloquy and monologue song. But what do you have next?
I have love ballads.
I think we go love ballad there. Going from villains, like, you gotta go love.
I mean, we have to go love.
It's true. Okay, so give us the rundown on a love ballad.
I mean, it simply is a ballad or a duet about love, and it can be complicated love, Oklahoma.
Yes,
people will say we're in love.
Yep.
Why do they think up stories that link my name with yours?
Why do the neighbors chatter all day behind their doors?
I know a way to prove what they say is quite untrue. Here is the gist, a practical list of don'ts for you.
Gotta have the conflict.
Like, I don't know if people will look at us and think that we're in love. Is that a good thing? Is that a bad thing? And then you have, like, you have different love songs. You have Wheels of a Dream from Ragtime.
Yeah.
Then we'll travel on from there.
California, who knows where?
And we will run on the wheels of a dream.
Which I think is a great love song.
Yes.
Because it's about hope.
On the wheels of a dream.
That's it. Absolutely. And I think it's so full. I think a love ballad has to have the possibility.
Yes.
Of, it's just, it has to have possibility.
Yes. And and the better you set that possibility up, and especially if it's a tragedy and doesn't end well, the harder the fall is. Like, look at Tonight. From West Side Story. That beautiful balcony scene where you just see the young passion of these two people coming. Tragedy what happens to him at the end.
And there's a couple of love songs in Ragtime. You have Wheels of a Dream and you have Our Children, which happens at the end.
Exactly.
Which is a late blooming kind of romance.
Exactly.
And then you have something like Together at Last from Annie.
True.
Which is a different kind of love.
Exactly. Paternal,
and
fatherly love.
You kind of have, like, if you look at something like Evan Hansen.
True.
And For Forever.
Yes.
The idea of something big happening, even though it's an aria, basically.
Yes.
It's a solo number.
Yes.
He just wants something other than the life he's living.
Exactly.
Right? These dreams. So they have to possess hope.
Yes.
And then, you know, you have the reprise.
Yes.
Or the reprise.
Yes.
Depending where you're from in the world.
Yes.
I've
always
wondered
as reprise.
Right? Is the resolve of love.
Yes.
Tomorrow from Annie is kind of a love ballad.
Yep.
Right? But where in Act One, it's tomorrow, you're always a day away.
Right.
In Act Two, becomes only.
Right.
So that's a vast difference in one word, right?
Yes.
So it's a bit of a resolve.
Yes.
Of the ballad.
I agree with
people
that.
People finding each other or coming to some kind of resolution.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Absolutely. Okay. So I guess now we'll head into monologues and soliloquy songs. Because those can go in either Act 1 or Act 2.
Absolutely.
You can find them all over a musical.
100%.
So
I love a good soliloquy.
There's
yes.
so many good ones. Heck, there's even one called Soliloquy from
Carousel.
I've got to get ready before she comes. I've got to make certain that she won't be dragged up in slums with a lot of bums like me. She's gotta be sheltered and fed and dressed in the best that money can buy. I never knew how to get money, but I'll try, my God, I'll try. I'll go out and make it, or steal it, or take it, or die.
I'm glad
best,
you right.
The best soliloquy. It's so it's
Billy
messy.
Bigelow.
Billy Bigelow.
That
I
guy.
Love that musical.
Oh. Bit of a problematic musical, but I'm sure we'll get into that once we
you
talk
know what?
About
everything's
that
everything's problematic.
It's true.
That's what makes it interesting.
It's true.
Come on.
But yeah, so you can find them in either Act 1 or Act 2. Mm-hmm. It's usually sung by the main character, or it could be sung by a major supporting character,
mm-hmm.
like for example, like an Ado Annie in Oklahoma. I Can't Say No is a great example of a soliloquy monologue ballad song where she's expressing her internal issues of wanting to be in open relationships with guys all over.
Javert.
Actually, that's one of my list songs is Javert's Suicide at the uh-huh. end of Les Mis. That is like the epitome of a soliloquy song.
What sort of devil is he to have me caught in a trap and choose to let me go free? It was his hour at last to put a seal on my fate. Wipe of the past, I must be clean of the slate. All it would take was a flick of his knife. Vengeance was his, and he gave me back my life.
And actually, it mirrors Belle John's soliloquy at the top of Act One.
What have I done? Sweet Jesus, what have I done? Become a thief in the night, become a dog in the run. Have I fallen so far, and is the hour so late that nothing remains but the cry of my hate? The cries in the dark that nobody hears. Here where I stand at the turning of the years.
So, those songs always come up, and it's very Shakespearean usually. It's always a character's inner thoughts and feelings about particular situations. It's normally sung at a moment of high emotion, when characters can do nothing else but express their feelings and inner thoughts through song. It's that great thing of like in a musical, people only sing when they can't speak anymore or sing anymore. They go and dance. It's that continued heightened emotion. So that's what an internal
Absolutely.
Monologue is.
And it, you know, it is an expression of inner thoughts,
mm-hmm.
but when I'm working with people on soliloquy,
yeah.
I say they're puzzles.
Yes.
They're things that you're struggling between.
Yes.
It's that famous going back to, you know, to be or not to be.
Exactly.
Right? There's always this torn element.
Yes.
And when I work with high school students, I say it's like that night before an exam where you're like, should I go get the pizza pocket? Or should I just cram one more bit of information into
yep.
my head? Should I watch Game of Thrones on repeat? Or should I just read my history book?
Right.
Right? It's the turmoil of the choice.
Yes.
There always has to be a choice involved.
Yes.
And in Billy Bigelow,
yeah.
he's choosing between, well, do I want to be a father to a boy
or a girl?
And what are the differences between
mm-hmm.
those two things? And how will I
provide.
Shift who I am?
Yeah.
How will I provide for them?
Also, doesn't make the best choice in that shift. Poor Billy Bigelow.
Poor Billy Bigelow. Everyone will be up in arms when they hear that we said poor Billy Bigelow, but he is.
He is a tragic figure.
Yeah. Well, he is also, you know, a product of his environment.
True.
Right?
Yeah.
And I think we have to always look at each character
yep.
with the utmost empathy.
True.
To find out how they got to where they are.
Exactly.
In that moment.
Even the worst characters have some small gray fleck of good in their heart.
Absolutely.
I mean, look at Darth Vader, Queen Amidala, and like Luke always say about their dad. There's still good in him.
Absolutely. It's the same thing with Archibald's brother in Secret Garden.
Yes.
Right?
Exactly.
Like just this idea of never feeling like you're enough.
Yes.
And what does that do to your soul?
Yes.
Ugh.
Right?
Ugh.
So yeah, that's a great few examples of the soliloquy slash monologue song.
Yes.
All right. Next, I have the patter song. What do you have next?
Oh, I have the comedy solo duet.
Let's do that first.
Let's do that.
And then we'll head into a patter song because that can go anywhere.
I mean, really, a comedy solo duet.
Yeah.
Is kind of like a soliloquy.
Yes.
But only told by the comedic characters.
It's true.
So, it's a little bit farcical.
Yes.
Sue Me from Guys and Dolls is
yes.
like the, or A Person Can Develop a Cold
yes.
from Guys and Dolls.
Yes.
Agony from Into the Woods.
While they lie there for years,
and you cry on their beers,
what unbearable bliss. Agony that can cut like a knife. Ah, well, back to my.
Yeah,
it's usually the supporting characters
yes.
that do it, but you also have musicals that are full comedies.
True,
like Spamalot.
Yes,
and you have You Won't Succeed on Broadway.
So listen, Arthur, darling, closely to this news. We won't succeed on Broadway if we don't have any Jews. You may have the finest sets, fill the stage with penthouse pets. You may have the loveliest costumes and best shoes. You may dance and you may sing, but I'm sorry, Arthur King, you'll hear no cheers, just lots and lots of booze.
True.
Which is a big comedy number.
Yes.
Right?
Or Keep It Gay from the producers.
Yes. Love it. Right.
A happy ending will pep up your play.
Oedipus won't bomb
if he winds up with mom.
Keep it gay.
Keep it gay.
Keep it gay.
So it's really just to keep the comedic
yep.
element in there.
It's true, because every show needs it.
Every show, well, do they? I don't know. Well, that's a debate. That's a big debate.
I think so. I think every show needs the comedy.
Because Les Mis doesn't have comedy.
Master of the House.
Is it comedic? I don't know.
It's comedic in the tune, and it tricks
yes.
the audience into thinking it's funny, when really the innkeeper is robbing and cheating his customers.
But as the audience,
we're all chuckling because he's tripping the blind guy, or he's ripping the shoes off somebody who doesn't know it, or he's taking the wallet out of the back pocket, and we're all chuckling because it's like, that is that inner evilness that we all have.
Yeah, to do
that,
it. Yeah.
That it's like, haha.
I wonder if I could do that.
To be honest, I don't think I could because I don't think I could either. But mind you, I'm not living in the world of the innkeeper. He's just trying to make money.
That's right.
On a side road inn. Actually, another example is Lovely Ladies from Les Mis as well. That is another up-tempo song that can come across as comedic because you have all the funny things that the prostitutes are doing with their customers.
That's true.
But at the same time, you have the descent of Fontaine going on off on the side stage. But once again, like, and actually the reason why they wrote Lovelies the way they did was because we've had a whole bunch of songs in Act One already that are just being soliloquies and dire and sad. We need something that's going to pick the audience up a bit and
absolutely.
Move through a lot of exposition, which is, I think, another great thing comedy songs do, is they can move through a lot of exposition that just has to get out. And
that
a great way
true.
To do that is just to give them to the comedic character who's just going to plow through it and like get you to the next point of the story.
Or it could just be for sheer relief.
It's true,
because
audiences need that.
Relief.
And we'll get into that with G. Officer Krupke. And
I was going to say G. Officer Krupke is the perfect example of
it
that.
It is. And that, we're definitely going to talk about it, like, is it in the right spot in the show? Because that is a debate that I've had with people.
Well, and even going back into the classics, Shakespeare
yes.
did it.
Yeah, well, look at the Porter.
If you look at Winter's Tale, yep. Or if you look at Feste and Twelfth yes. Night, or...
The Porter and Macbeth.
The Porter and Macbeth.
I mean, like, we just killed Duncan, and all of a sudden out comes the drunk Porter. Who's going to give the audience a pee break to go out and, like, relax while he goes and pontificates about life from his point of view?
Yeah. And you have Mercutio and R&J.
Exactly. There's a lot of great comedical moments in dark, tragic shows. It's the way the comedy is done in the show. If it feels too schmaltzy and, like... Here comes the comedy number, it can defeat the song because the audience goes, you're trying to be funny now. You're not actually being funny.
Well, and there's also musicals. Yes. And then there's musical comedy.
True.
So like...
That are all Spamalot.
Spamalot. Guys and Dolls is a musical comedy.
Yes, it
is. Whereas Oklahoma is not.
No, it has it has funny moments. But it's definitely not a...
I can't say no is hilarious.
Yes.
Kansas City, big, raucous, hilarious, right? They're a release. Like, Agony is a perfect
fantastic
example.
Fantastic one.
Right? Perfect.
Yes.
Perfect example.
Actually, the reprise is better than the original in Act 1. It's even funnier.
They're just... They're great.
It's true.
I love the princes in that show.
I would love to play one of the princes.
I would love to see that. That'd be great. So what's your next one?
I have the Patter song.
Okay.
Which is a really technical song when it comes
to... I'll say it is.
Yeah. Because, I mean, according to Wikipedia, this is what they've written about the Patter song, because I wanted to get a definitive definition. So on Wikipedia, it is written as a song that is characterized as an up-tempo rhythmic song that has each note representing a syllable of text. The lyrics are often tongue-twisting and alliterative words. The songs can often be used for comedic effect. So you have things like from HMS Pinafore, and a lot of Gilbert and Sullivan use a Patter song.
Well, Pirates of Penzance.
Exactly.
Modern Major General. The very model of a Modern Major General.
Family Guy does a great parody of that song.
They were geniuses at writing Patter songs.
Yes.
Brilliant.
Now, there are some modern ones, too. Mm-hmm. So we have things like All for the Best from Godspell.
Some men are born to live at ease, doing what they please, richer than the bees are in honey. Never growing old, never feeling cold, pulling pots of gold from thin air. The best in every town, best at shaking down, best at making mountains of money. They can't take it with them, but what do they care?
Yes.
You also have things like Not Getting Married Today from Company, which is like the epitome of modern Patter.
Pardon me, is everybody there? Because if everybody's there, I want to thank you all for coming to the wedding. I'd appreciate you going even more. I mean, you must have lots of better things to do. And not a word of it to Paul. Remember, Paul, you know the man I'm getting married, but I'm not, because I wouldn't ruin anyone as wonderful as he is. But I thank you all for the gifts and the flowers. Thank you all. Now it's back to the showers. Don't tell Paul, but I'm not getting married today.
Absolutely.
Like, it's always fun to see how fast the actor can go with that song, because you see some actors who just can't do the speed that Sondheim wanted.
Oh, yeah. No, I know.
And then there's
also, there's also one in The Witches of Eastwick.
Is there? Okay. And then I think another great Patter song is You Got Trouble. It's a bit of a slower patter. It's not as fast. But at the same time, it's that rapping. But
well, you've also got Cash for the Merchant.
Yes. Yes. Rock Island. Yes. Yeah, that matches the train.
What is that?
I love that opening. That's one of my favorite musical openings.
Cash for the merchandise. Cash for the button hooks. Cash for the cotton goods. Cash for the hard goods. Cash for the fancy goods. Cash for the soft goods. Cash for the noggins and the piggins and the frickins. Cash for the hogshead cask and demijohn. Cash for the crackers and the pickles and the flypaper.
Look, what do you talk? What do you talk? What do you talk? What do you talk? What do you talk?
Where do you get it?
What do you talk?
It's unexpected.
Exactly.
Which is amazing.
And once again, it's a really interesting way of setting up the world and the characters of the musical, where you don't even meet Marion Peru and the whole people of what's the city they're in Music Man? River City.
River City.
They're in River City, Iowa. So it's the fact you don't even get to meet them, but you already understand what the world you're in just from the traveling salesman on the train.
The one by in Witches of Eastwick.
Yeah, what is it?
Words, words, words.
Words, words, words. That's a great example of a Patter song.
It's like blah 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 blah, and it was Maria Friedman did it.
Oh, okay.
And it's a patter song between Suki and Daryl Van Horn.
Love it.
It's great. It's really, no one knows this musical.
Words, 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 words.
Oh, sweetheart.
I'd like to talk about the world I never get to see from home. I'd like to talk about Caracas and the Pleiades and Rome. I'd like to talk about the rise. I'd like to talk about the fall. I'd like to talk about the doings at your basic bacchanal. Oh, not that I approve, but when it's all been said and done, I mean, you gotta give them this. The Romans sure can have some fun. Then, of course, you've got the French, the Pakistanis, and the Dutch. Tell me, Daryl, is it me or am I talking way too much?
It's true.
It's all because of Ian McShane.
Ian McShane, Lucy Arnaz, Maria Friedman, Joanna Riding.
Jack Nicholson did a great movie version of it.
Yeah, that guy.
That guy.
That guy. No one's heard of him, have they?
It's true. No, I don't think so. Who is he?
Ian McShane, Jack Nicholson. I mean,
I can see the correlation between the two of them.
Totally.
They both got that toothy smile.
Oh, yeah. Kind of devilishly handsome.
Exactly.
Yeah. So but that's Patter Songs.
Yeah, basically, it's a technical song.
Now, Patter Songs go into my next.
Okay, what's yours? Theme,
which are listing songs.
Yes, a different version of that type of Patter Songs. Kind of mere coin of it. It's like kind of like two things of the same coin, just different sides.
Exactly. Listing songs list things.
It's true.
So you've got, you know, Raindrops on Roses,
yep.
Whiskers on Kittens.
Yep.
And then you've got my favorite.
Which
are
is?
You ready?
Okay, give it to me.
I'm going
to
read it off to you
here.
It was red and yellow and green and brown and scarlet and black and ochre and peach and ruby and olive and violet and fawn and lilac and gold and chocolate and mauve and cream and crimson and silver and rose and azure and lemon and russet and gray and purple and white and pink and orange and red and yellow and green and brown, scarlet and black and ochre and peach and ruby and... Do you know what it is?
I want to see Sunday in the Park with George.
No! I look handsome. I look smart.
Oh!
Joseph's coat color.
Yes!
Yes, that is the best example of
true.
A listing song.
All the colors in the coat.
Yep.
You make a great narrator.
Oh, thanks.
For that
I
show.
I would love to play that. That'd be great. If I could hit all those notes, it'd be even better for the audience.
I remember as a kid, I saw it with Susan Gilmore. Playing she was fantastic.
Maria Friedman played it.
There you go.
In London.
Right.
Amazing.
Yes. Such a good.
I love it.
Such a fun kids musical.
Lloyd Webber.
Oh, trust me. Lloyd Webber comes up, I think. Actually, he comes up twice this season.
Twice. He does.
He comes up twice. We're doing two Lloyd Webbers this year. But not Joseph. That's what we're doing. We have two other ones.
We're doing the companion piece to Joseph.
Exactly. There's your first hint of what is one of our.
So that's listing songs. La Vie Boheme from Rent.
There you go.
As well.
Yeah. Rent. That show.
Oh.
Not.
I'm sensing some disdain, friends.
Oh, there's some disdain.
I love it.
Okay. We're never going to...
I love that musical.
We're never going to have a debate about that.
Okay, we can.
That will be one that we'll have to debate when it's going to end up on the podcast at some point.
Oh,
you may have to force it on me.
Disdain.
Yeah, you may have to force it on me eventually. We'll talk about Rent at some point because I think it's one of the shows we will have to talk about, whether I want to or not. And when we do...
Jonathan Larson is a genius. Come on.
No, we'll get there. We're not going to spoil that. We're not going to spoil that debate.
We're not going to get there yet.
No.
Okay.
So what's the next one you have after listing?
I have Act One Finale.
All right, let's do it.
Let's do it.
Let's end our Act One here.
Act One Finale. I call it the purveyor of false hope.
Ooh.
Right? Everything is going great. And then we start Act Two. We have Defying Gravity.
Yes.
We have One Day More. We have Climb Every Mountain.
Yes.
Don't Rain on My Parade. Ever After from Into the Woods.
Yes.
It is gravitas galore.
Yes.
Too bad
company.
The musical doesn't end here.
Nope. It's got to go into Act Two.
But the audience says, no, I need more despair and I need to watch the train wreck and
it's
full.
True.
Full form for my own personal catharsis.
Yes.
Let's go into Act Two.
Love it.
Let's have a drink at the bar and go into Act Two. I love Act One finales.
It's true.
I love them.
It really sets the tone for the musical. And like,
if
a show does not have a good Act One finish, it's hard for the audience to come back and enjoy an Act Two because they just go,
yeah,
what am I coming back for?
Well, and you also have to leave with hope.
Yes.
So, like, Act One finales are always hope-filled.
Yes. Even the most dire shows have a
Act One. Day one. More.
Yes. Everybody's going to go off
day.
And die.
It's like this huge, let's do it. We are going to win against the hypocrisy of our politicians.
Yep. And then they all die.
And the regime. We will damn this regime.
We'll have our night at the opera, as they say.
Yeah, exactly.
Because everyone wants to go to the opera. Tomorrow we'll discover what our God in heaven has in store. One more dawn, one more day, one day
more. And then everyone dies.
Yeah.
Spoiler alert. Sorry about that.
Spoiler for a 30-year-old musical and also a over 100-year-old book.
That's true. Yeah.
So they're on the roof. I think that's one of the few downer endings of Act One with the sacking of Seidel's wedding. But yet somehow you love Tevye so much and that fiddler that you're invested now. You want to see what happens to them in Act Two.
Well, it's not only that. Yes, they sack it. And there's still a possibility that things can get better.
It's true.
You're like, oh, well, it can't get worse.
It's true. Until, come on, Tevye.
Until Anna Tefka.
It's
true. And then you're like, oh, why didn't I stay at the bar during intermission? Ideas.
No, exactly. No. Act One ends with hope.
Yes.
And then it all goes to shit from there.
Yeah.
What do you have next?
I have the entr'acte. And then I think it's all you after that.
All right. Because I only have two after that. So what is
what
the
do you have left?
I have the 11 o'clock number and the finale.
Oh, no, I need to go.
Yeah, you gotta go first. So
entr'acte.
What happens there?
It's basically a shorter, I put in brackets, hopefully, version of the overture. So basically it's just a reestablishing of the musical theme.
It's true. I don't think the Phantom at entr'acte is shorter than the overture.
No.
It's just as long.
Oh, Phantom.
We'll get into Phantom.
Yeah.
We'll get into Phantom. I think there's potential there. I just think they focus on the wrong element of the story, where they go for the love when they should go for the suspense and the drama and the thriller. Like, go back to that classic gothic horror that was originally meant for the Phantom. Phantom was never meant as a love story.
Who starred in that on screen?
Lon Chaney. So yes, entr'acte.
Okay, entr'acte. Entr'acte. Yes, we're done with entr'acte.
Okay.
They're the in between.
Right.
They're like, here we go again. Yep. Are you ready for
more misery and loss of hope?
Depression galore.
But sometimes they end up happily. You never know.
Do they ever though? It's like Twelfth Night. Does Twelfth Night end happily?
True.
Big question.
There's a wedding, but is it a really happy wedding?
Is it happy wedding?
Good question. We get into Twelfth Night. That'll be our other podcast, Mac and Autumn Talk Shakespeare.
Oh, Lord help us.
And we do that. That'll be a spinoff series that we'll do eventually. Actually, I think we can have some fun with that.
Yes.
So
we'll call it the heartbeat.
I love it.
Like iambic pentameter.
Okay.
That was really
trademark. Crazy. Trademark. We're keeping that. That's ours. Nobody else gets that one.
Oh goodness.
All right. So then I guess we move into the 11 o'clock number.
11 o'clock number.
And this is one that goes two different directions. I found two different ways people look at the 11 o'clock number. So once again, Wikipedia, great friend of mine. They often have great definitions of what is what.
It's everyone's friend.
It's true.
It's like essay writing. I'm just kidding.
Yeah, never do use that on an essay. It will not end well for you. The 11 o'clock number. So it takes place at the end of the musical. Usually it's the second to last song before the finale. It's usually normally big, and it can certainly be qualified as a showstopper.
Go big or go home.
Exactly. It's one of those things where it's going to give you the audience that last bit of huzzah to get them into that final act.
Absolutely.
A finale of the show. So if it is sung by the supporting characters as either a solo, a duet, or a group, it's meant to give the audience one last moment of levity before an extremely emotional finale. And on the other hand, if the song is sung by, say, the protagonist or the lead of the show, it's something where the character has to have the big major moment of revelation to then propel them into the final song of the show. So there's two different ways you can go about a big
number. It's like a belter's dream.
It's true. It's true. So good examples are you gotta get a gimmick from Gypsy, which is great.
Do you think that's the 11 o'clock number?
I think so, because I would say so, because you get that song and then I don't qualify the strip, as a song, I think that's just
Rose's turn.
No, I think that's the finale because no, after that, that's the show's
both.
Done.
It's both.
I said both. See, once again, murky gray.
It's 11 into midnight. It's
there.
Like,
you go.
It's the big.
Yes.
See, for me, an 11 o'clock number is the big.
The big moment.
I can't even actually put it into words. It's like that gut wrenching, like.
Yes.
The thing that needs to happen.
True.
To close the curtain.
Right. So another example would be No Good Deed from Wicked. I think that's a great 11 o'clock. Remember, because right after that, you have March of the Witch Hunter, which is like kind of a nothing number where it's like, got to give Elphaba time to relax before she hit, before they have the big emotional For Good at the end.
Yeah.
And to be honest, I don't think For Good's a big 11 o'clock number. Like the way Elphaba belts in No Good Deed, and she, and also it's her big moment of revelation.
It is
she,
revelation, but that's...
All laws be agreed. I'm wicked through and through since I cannot succeed.
Why Rose's turn?
True.
Revelation.
Good point. I concede that.
Right.
Another comedic example would be Beggars at the Feast from Les Mis, where the innkeeper and his wife come back at one last time to have one final comedic zinger at the audience, where they openly mock the world around them by saying, you know what? Screw it. Like, we got here by screwing everybody else over, and that's the only way to get.
It's the only way we're going to continue to get.
Exactly.
Through life.
Exactly. And a lot of times it's a fantastic 11 o'clock, short but sweet moment.
Watch the bucket salts. Watch them do their job. Keep it with the value when you stand on top. Losses of the land. Always get our share. Clear away the barricades and we're still there. We know where the wind is blowing.
Because after that, you get right into Valjean's death. And that's a super sad moment full of ghosts and dead bodies. And Now, would you say G. Officer Krupke is an 11 o'clock number? Because I would say so. If it comes normally where it does in Act 2, not in the film version, but in the Act 2, it's come after the Somewhere Ballet.
Right.
And then you go into G. Officer Krupke. And then you have the final song, which is the A Boy Like That duet.
That's the 11 o'clock number.
Would you say?
Yes. Because it's full. Officer Krupke is comedic. It's like true. Comedic, like.
Let's get you guys like lined up
Boy
for
like
the
that
end.
That duet.
True.
And tonight.
I Have a Love, yeah.
I Have a Love. Not tonight. I Have a Love. It's like, it's.
It's that final revelation.
11 o'clock numbers need to excavate.
True.
They're an excavation of soul.
True.
Right?
See, this is interesting that we find different ways of looking at the 11
Wikipedia
o'clock.
Wikipedia is wrong.
All right, we'll have to change that.
I'm trying to think of other, like, big...
I know, right? Like, I guess Moments in the Woods from Into the Woods, that's the 11 o'clock. Or no, I guess Last Midnight.
Yeah, Last Midnight.
The Last Midnight with the witch.
It's something that needs to bring the house down.
It's true. And there has to be different ways of bringing that house down. Because, I mean, I would definitely say Brush Up Your Shakespeare from Kiss Me, Kate. I would definitely say that's the 11 o'clock number.
Brush up your Shakespeare. Start quoting him now. Brush up your Shakespeare. And no women, you will wow. Just declaim a few lines from Otella, and they'll think you're a hell of a fella.
I would say...
Because it's that last moment of levity before you end the finale with Kate's big soliloquy.
Music in the Mirror.
Ooh, good one.
That's a big one.
Good one.
That is a really big one. Name me a musical. We'll find another one.
All right. Let's do...
Let's find another one.
I'm trying to think of ones that we're not going to talk about this season because I don't want to spoil. Okay. Well, I mean, I guess one for Fiddler would be Anatevka.
Well, that's a really sad one.
Yeah.
That's a downer.
Yep, that's a downer. What's another upbeat one that we can talk about?
Upbeat.
11 o'clock number.
11 o'clock. numbers. I'm a really loud typer, everyone.
I love it.
I apologize. The five best 11 o'clock numbers.
What are they?
Let's see. Rose's Turn.
Classic. Yep, we talked about that one.
Bookend to some people.
Okay.
Yeah, absolutely. Let's see. Brush Up Your Shakespeare.
Told you, yeah.
Yeah, for sure. Some of these musicals I don't know. Send in the Clowns, 11 o'clock number.
Yeah. What's getting a downer?
You'll Never Walk Alone.
Great.
11 o'clock number. Memory.
Yo.
Memory.
Yes.
Of course.
Street lamp dies, another night is over, another day is dawning. Touch me, it's so easy to leave me all alone with the memory of my days in the sun. If you touch me, you'll understand what happiness is. Look, a new day has begun.
Love Memory.
Of course that is an 11 o'clock number. Of course.
Memory.
Ladies Who Lunch.
Love that.
What I Did for Love. But I don't think.
I don't agree with that.
I don't agree with that. Memory is, and Send in the Clowns, I would say absolutely.
Yeah.
Sit Down, You're Rocking the Boat.
Good 11 one.
11 o'clock number.
Good one.
Miller's Son. Maybe.
Maybe.
Make Them Hear You.
Right.
Yeah, from Ragtime.
Yeah. I would say All the Wasted Time from Parade. That big final, love duet between Leo and Lucille.
I do not know that musical well, but that song.
Oh, you're going to know that musical well, because that one is also coming up in season one, and it's one of my favorite musicals of all time.
I love that song. Brent Carver sang
Oh,
that
my
song.
Goodness, with Carly Carmelo.
Oh, her voice is butter. The American Dream, Miss Saigon.
Yeah, love that song.
Yeah, absolutely.
Such a grimy, dirty song you can have so much fun with.
Cabaret. That's a whole other rabbit hole.
I know.
Well, that'll be season two.
We'll definitely have some Kerner and Ebb in season two.
Definitely.
We're saving them for season two. We got some other fun ones.
Why am I shutting my computer down?
I don't know.
Those are big 11 o'clock.
Yeah.
Memory.
Yes.
How could I miss that one?
I don't know, right? I'm thinking the same thing. So then we head into the finale.
Ta-da!
And it closes the show. It resolves the main character's plot. The finale usually focuses around either the main character's death or a wedding or a walk off into the sunset. Those are usually the three endings that happen.
Yeah.
Normally. So good examples of that are you have things like Rose's Turn that we've talked about from Gypsy.
Yeah.
That big final curtain closing moment.
Yeah.
Now, question to you. Do you like the fact that the musical, like you have Rose's Turn, big boom at the end of the song. And then there's this epilogue where like Gypsy Rose Lee comes back out and comforts her mom at the end of that. Because I don't like it. I like the idea of the show ending with, for me, and Rose's big boom and blackout and be done.
Everything's coming up, Rose. Everything's coming up, Rose. Everything's coming up, Rose. This time for me. For me. For me. For me. For me. For me.
Versus
Louise
come back out and comfort her mom and they walk off together.
Yeah, that's lame.
I find it kind of like...
Sorry.
I agree. Like if I was directing it, I would cut that moment.
I would too.
Because I
like things that end on a question mark.
It's true.
For me.
For me.
Question mark.
Yep.
Blackout.
Exactly.
Only time a blackout is allowed.
Exactly.
End of the show.
Yes.
Period.
Exactly. Another good example of a finale is Being Alive from Company.
Great ending.
Exactly.
Somebody crown me with love. Somebody push me to care. Somebody make me come through. I'll always be there, as frightened as you. The help of survive. Being alive. Being alive. Being alive.
That final moment of Bobby finally being ready to be open to love. And I think it's fascinating. And the way they did it in London with Rosalie Craig is fascinating. So when we talk about Company.
I can't wait.
We'll talk about this because it is fascinating.
Are we doing it in season one? I can't remember.
I don't want to say. I don't want to spoil it.
I can't remember.
I don't want to spoil it.
It's devastating.
So another example of them walking off into the sunset is the I Have a Dream from Mamma Mia, the reprise. Where Sophie and Sky walk off with the moon in the background.
Friends, this is where I roll my eyes when it comes to Mamma Mia.
Darn it, I was going to have that in season two. I actually have a soft spot for Mamma Mia.
Do you have a soft spot for Mamma Mia or do you have a soft spot for ABBA?
Ooh.
Because I have a soft spot for ABBA and I adore ABBA. I've adored ABBA since like Eurovision,
true.
Waterloo. But Mamma Mia, I'm like... But money.
Oh.
That show makes money.
Oh yeah, because everybody loves those songs, and they'll come out like the fact the movie musical was made into a sequel, a prequel slash sequel.
It was terrible.
It was terrible, but it was fun.
Meryl Streep really wasn't in it. They brought in Cher instead.
They brought in Cher, which I mean, you can't really go wrong with Cher.
How can you hate Cher, even though it was terrible?
I mean, the one good moment of that whole movie was the baptism moment where Ghost Meryl Streep
comes back. More.
I mean, like, don't worry, it's not a spoiler. It was in the trailers that like Meryl Streep is not around in this one, except in flashback.
No, she dies.
She dies. Off screen, too.
We didn't even get to see it.
We need to see how she dies. It's just, oh, she's dead. Darn.
We didn't get an ABBA song on her deathbed.
No.
Nothing.
But yeah, so that's another great example. And then the classic classic finale of a show is Oklahoma from Oklahoma.
O-K-L-A-H-O-M-A.
Exactly.
Shall
Oklahoma.
Oklahoma.
Yeah. Same here. That's where I knew how to spell Oklahoma.
Oh my God.
But yeah, that song is like the epitome of a classic Broadway finale. Where it's like, go out with the jazz hands.
Yeah, totally.
Judd's dead. Woohoo.
Judd's dead. Everything's okay.
Exactly. Curly and Lori are off to with their buggy into the sunset with the Surrey with the fringe on the top. It's a great time.
Yeah. Marriage.
Yeah.
People will know they're in love.
Exactly. So it's a fair time. It's a great time.
Great time to be alive.
Exactly. And I guess there you have it. We've just done 14 types of songs you can normally find in a musical. So
woo!
Yay us with that one. So now I think we'll have to let the audience know what to regularly expect.
Let's do
from us. So the way our normal podcast rundown will work is every week we will introduce the musical to you.
Mm-hmm.
Autumn will then give us a brief history of the creative teams.
Brief.
A brief fun history that highlights their careers and what they got up to. I will then give you a fun historical production history of the musical.
Oh.
And why was it made? What was going on historically that kind of inspired it?
Mm.
And then we will segue into the fun parts, which is Autumn and I will both reveal our top three favorite songs of the musical. And then we'll also reveal our top three least favorite songs of the musical and whether or not we will cut them or do something about them. So
that's right. And should this piece be revisited in our current climate?
Yes.
As well as how you and I came to the piece.
Exactly. We'll talk about all that type of fun stuff coming up in Before the Downbeat.
I love it.
Yes. So I think we'll sign off for this episode. Fantastic. So yes. So
thanks for listening.
Yes. Thank you, everybody. I also want to thank our good friend, Mr. Brody Wells, for creating our musical opening theme music.
Oh, fantastic.
Yes.
Way to go, Brody.
Thank you. And also, in the meantime, while you wait for our next show, be sure to check us out on all social media forums. We are at Facebook with Before the Downbeat, same as on Instagram and on Twitter. We are currently building a Patreon page for you. So that will be released later in a couple of episodes. So keep your eyes and ears peeled for that. And I guess, Autumn, where can people find you if they want to connect with you on social media and hear all the fun stuff that you're up to?
Well, you can friend me personally on Facebook or Instagram.
Do it.
Autumn TM Smith.
Autumn TM Smith. Done.
Great.
And you can find me at Mackenzie Horner on all social media platforms as well. Once again, just request. We'll let you in. It's a great time.
We'll let you in.
I post a lot of fun recipes, so you can't go wrong there.
I'll check it out.
Yeah. Cool. Other than that, we thank you again. We look forward to seeing you in a theater enjoying a piece of musical theater. Thanks, everybody.
See you
soon. Bye.
Bye-bye.